So Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. You know this, come on. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. That sounded pretty good out there. Not bad. Anyway. How many, anybody that was the first time for you singing that song, hearing that song? Anybody? I mean, yeah, we've all heard that song, right? You know where it comes from? In 1860, it was a poem written, let me get the name right, by Anna Bartlett Warner. And it was included in a book that her sister had just written. The book is called Say and Seal, and it's written by her sister, Susan Warner. And it was actually a poem that was read to a child while that child was dying. And that was the context of the words to that song. And so I thought that was interesting. My question is that true? I mean, not what I just told you. That's true because I Googled it, and the Google doesn't lie, right? But is it true that Jesus loves you? And is it true that you know that because the Bible tells you so? I mean, do you believe this, what's in this book? You see, we're in a series called This Is Us, and we're beginning to explore what does it mean for us as a church as we're kind of launching our next phase, our new church coming up May 21st. It's going to be a great day. You want to be part of it. But we're going through our core beliefs, and we're just walking through those. And last week we started last week with this one. It's at the top of the list. We believe in God. We believe that God is expressed in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we said that as people of faith, it's more than just that we believe in the existence of this triune God and in the work of Jesus and in the infilling of the Holy Spirit and his work. We also believe that this God is good, and here was the big one, that faith is magnetic. Faith draws us. It moves us. And so when we say that we're people of faith, we are moved towards this good God. That's what faith really is about. It's not just God exists, and it's not just that God is good, but it's that it moves us. We're people of faith. It moves us towards God. But today, our second statement of belief is this, that the truth about God is found in the Bible as contained in the Old and New Testaments. There we find who God is and how we relate to God, each other, and the world in which we live. And so today, I just want us to wrestle with that a little bit. Today is going to be a little bit different. It's going to be a question and answer kind of day. I'm going to ask the questions and answer them too, because it works better that way. But there are a lot of questions, right? Like, why does this Bible even exist? And what is this Bible? And where does it come from? And why should we trust it? Can we trust it? And why do different people read it and disagree about what it says? And why these 66 books in it? And there's just a lot of questions. So today we're going to dive into it, but we're going to end it with one big question. One big question that hopefully will get us all thinking pretty deeply about this. And that question, I'll go ahead and give you the heads up. That question is, if not this book, then where? Where do you get your information about God? So let's just jump in. And here's the first question. What is the Bible? Well, that's the book I'm holding, right? Well, right. Well, the Bible is actually not a book. It's actually a collection of 66 different documents. And some are letters, some are poems, and some are books, if you will. History kind of books. Now, for those of you who like a little history, the Bible was written over about 1,600 years, but the time that it covers is about 3,500 plus years, because before they started writing it down, they told the stories way before then. And then they actually began to write the stories a little later on. And then we have the collection of scripture during that about 1600 years. There's over 40 plus authors who have written parts of the Bible. And here you go. If you ever go on Jeopardy, thank you very much. Just tithe on the winnings here. Here's the answer to your question. There are 31,102 verses in the Bible, and they are containing 783,131 words. Aren't you glad you came to church today to know that? Yes? Where else would you get that information, right? But here's the reality is, what is the Bible? Well, the Bible is a story of God. Not everything we know about God, but of God's creation here on this earth. And it's also the story of our rebellion from God. And then ultimately, his attempt to reunite us into his family. That's what the Bible is. That's the story of the scripture. Now, next question. Why do we even have the Bible? And you may have never even thought about this, but why do we have this book? And I mean, we could say because God wanted us to have it. Okay, yeah, that's the right church answer. If we put it in one word, the one word, why do we have this book, is the resurrection. It's the resurrection. It's the fact that Jesus is no longer in the grave. Think of the scripture verses that Leslie read for us today. Thank you for reading for us, Leslie. There in Luke's account there, he says, many have undertaken to draw up an account of things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those from whom the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself, this is Luke, he's a physician, he's very exacting. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account to you, most excellent Theophilus, that's a friend of his, so that you may know the certainty of the things you have been taught. So what's going on here? So Luke is writing this book, this gospel. Gospel is simply a word that means good news, and it specifically is relating to Jesus. It's the good news about Jesus. Now, let's go back to the first century. In the first century, there were all these people giving their lives to this prophet, Messiah, Son of God, called Jesus. And they were claiming that Jesus was and is the Son of God, and that he resurrected from the dead. And they were giving their lives to Jesus. They were changing. It was changing everything about them. It was changing the way they did business. It was changing their family relationships. In fact, some families would ostracize them because they accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And the world was changing around Jerusalem because of this idea, this person that they say was resurrected from the grave. And people were giving their lives to Jesus. And there were these little communities forming called the ecclesia, the church, and they were doing life together. They were sharing meals together. They were having communion regularly. And people wanted to know, what is this really all about? What's going on? Who was this Jesus? Who is this Jesus? And so Luke is one of many who sat down to write an account of Jesus' life. And we actually get a little insight into Luke's gospel. He says, I interviewed the eyewitnesses. I went back and I talked to Mary. I talked to Peter. I talked to Lazarus. I talked to these people. And I've written down their accounts, their words of the story of Jesus. Because Theophilus, I want you to know this truth. And not only Theophilus, but this letter, this book has stood the test of time, and we actually have it here today. And it's not the only gospel we have. There are three other gospels, right? There's Matthew, which Matthew was written by the disciple Matthew, telling us the story of Jesus. There's Mark, which Mark, again, is a gospel, the story of Jesus. It was written by a guy named Mark, but he got his information from a guy named Peter, one of the disciples of Jesus. And then there's the gospel of John, and John was either a disciple of Jesus, or it's interesting, there's some new scholarships that think that it might have been Lazarus. But either way, whoever wrote John, they were firsthand witnesses of Jesus. They knew Jesus. And see, people wanted to know about Jesus. Why did people want to know about Jesus? Because he was a good guy? Because he was a good teacher? Absolutely not. Because his grave was empty. Now get this. When these gospels were written, here's the exciting part. When these gospels were written, for me, people knew the story of Jesus. And they also knew what it meant to die on. They had seen crucifixions. Some of the people who read these gospels for the very first time could have actually witnessed Jesus being crucified. They could have actually talked to Jesus. And if they didn't talk to Jesus, more than likely they knew people who knew Jesus and who had talked to Jesus. Not only that, but these gospels were written in a time after Jesus' resurrection. So you could read this gospel and somebody could say, hey, let's walk over to the garden tomb, and we actually know which garden tomb it was because it was just a few years ago, and there's still a vacancy sign on it because nobody's there, and I want to show you that empty tomb. And not only that, but there were people still alive when these gospels were written who saw the resurrected Jesus. And so these gospels were written for us because why? Because Jesus was resurrected from the grave. And people again began following him and began basing their life upon him and began trusting him as their Messiah and Lord. And some of these people were not Jewish. They were Gentile. They were non-Jewish people. And so when they started following Jesus, they wanted to know more about this Messiah. And they kept hearing people say, well, it was prophesied in the Old Testament about, or it was prophesied in the Jewish scriptures about Jesus coming. And so they were going, well, we want to read that too, because if it tells us more about this Jesus, the one who was resurrected from the dead, we want to know about it. And so, friends, that's why you have the Old Testament in your Bibles. Because these new believers wanted to know, because they didn't grow up with the Old Testament, with the Jewish scriptures. So they wanted to know about the Jewish scriptures and about Jesus. So that's why we have the Old Testament in our Bible. And then the rest of the New Testament is all about what happened when these communities of faith formed together. And they were letters, literally written many times to individual churches about what it meant to follow Jesus and how God is wanting us to live in his kingdom and to live out the truths that Jesus taught us. So why do we have the Bible today? Well, the simple answer is because of Jesus, because he's not in the grave, and because of his resurrection. And that's why we have this book today. Now, next question. Well, then, how are we to understand or interpret the Bible? Well, if that's the reason why we have the Bible, then we should understand it through the lens of Jesus, right? We should understand it through the lens of Jesus. And this is where it gets difficult, because you read something in the Old Testament. Have you ever read something in the Old Testament and you go, are you kidding me? You ever done that? You ever done? Friends, they did not eat bacon in the Old Testament. I mean, bacon, right? For those of us who just came back from Israel, the first thing we did when we got home was find a Waffle House, right? And order a double, right? Bacon. Now why did they not eat bacon? What was that about? And how do we understand that through the lens of Jesus? Well, let me share this verse with you. Here's what Jesus said about the Old Testament. He said, do not think that I've come to abolish the laws or prophets. I did not come to abolish them, but I came to fulfill them. So what's the bacon about? Okay, so in the Old Testament, God was starting his people because every people group had their own God, right? And so God was wanting the world to know who he was and that he was calling people to be separated from the world and to be holy. And part of that separation for that people of God was a dietary restriction because he wanted others in the world to know that these were people who had set aside themselves to be holy, to honor God. And God says, I don't want you eating pork. And so they set that aside and they didn't eat bacon. But when Jesus came into the world, right, he fulfilled that prophecy and he opened the door for everybody to be part of his family, for everybody to be part of his kingdom. And in Jesus' kingdom, how do you know you're part of Jesus' kingdom? It's not about what you eat or what you drink, but Jesus said it's about how you love one another. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciple. So Jesus came and fulfilled what God was wanting to do by telling the people no bacon. He was wanting them to be set apart, set aside, and to be holy. When Jesus came, he took the spirit of that law and filled it and said it's more than just a dietary restriction. It's really about your heart and how you love each other and include others and set that as part of that standard. So that's what Jesus was doing. Now, what about all the moral laws and codes of the Old Testament then? Do they not still stand? Things like, who do I get to sleep with? And who shouldn't I sleep with, right? I mean, those are some big issues. Well, what did the Old Testament say? Well, remember what the Old Testament said. The Old Testament says, if a man commits adultery with another man's wife, with the wife of his, both the adulterer and the adulteress should be put to death. Woo, right? Now, what's the spirit of that law? Because again, Jesus said, I've come to fulfill the laws. What's the spirit of that law? Well, the spirit of that law is, if you commit adultery, you're just inviting death into your life. You're inviting death into your relationship, into the relationships that the other person has. You're inviting death into your own soul. Anytime we do anything against God called sin, it brings death. It brings a separation between us and God. And so, in the Old Testament, it was very clear, and God wanted to make it very clear that if this happens, this is what is the result of it, death. So Jesus comes around, and Jesus is walking the earth. In John chapter 8, many of you know the story. There's a woman caught in the very act of adultery. We don't know where the man went, but last time we checked, it took two. But anyway, there's a whole thing behind that. But this woman is dragged out in front of Jesus, and the priests, the people who studied this law, the people who quoted this verse, they said to Jesus, they said, Jesus, in the law, it says this woman should be put to death. And you remember what Jesus said, right? Jesus said, you're right. But you who are without sin should cast the first stone. Just cast the first stone. Now, there's only one person there without sin, and that was Jesus, and he didn't have a rock in his hand. He didn't throw the stone. So what was going on here? So after everybody left and they dropped their stones, Jesus looked to the woman, and he says, hey, daughter, where's your accusers? They're all gone. And he says, I don't accuse you either. He says, but hey, go and sin no more. Quit inviting death into your life. Why? Because Jesus is all about giving life. And think about it, so is in our Heavenly Father. Even in the Old Testament, God was all about wanting people to find life and to find it more abundantly. That's why he gave us these laws. And that's why Jesus came and he upholds that. He says, hey, listen, adultery still brings death every time. Brings death of your soul, death of your relationships. Brings death. Now, would Jesus say we're to physically stone him? No, because he said the spirit of the law reminds us that it's about what God is trying to do with the spirit of the law. So again, how do we read and interpret the scripture? You always interpret it through the lens of Jesus. So what then is the purpose of the Bible? Well, just very simply, the purpose of the Bible is then to bring us into a relationship with God who wants to give us life and to give it more abundantly. Here's what the scripture says. The Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the purpose of the scripture. You see, the scripture is not a science book. This is not a science textbook. It is not primarily a history book, although there is history in it. It is a book that is meant to bring us, to help us know who God is, who we are, and how we can enter into a relationship with him, and how we have find life through that relationship with him. That's the purpose of this book. Now, again, is there some history in it? Sure there is. And in fact, we'll talk just a little bit more about that. The more archaeologists are digging in the Holy Lands, the more truths they're finding in the scripture historically. It's like, oh yeah, that really happened, which only adds veracity to, well, this book. So next question. Why do people disagree about what the Bible says? That's a simple answer. Because nobody listens to me. Right? No, that's not at all. Here it is. Context, genre, and it's complex. Context, genre, and it's complex. You see, every document, every piece of the Bible was actually written to a specific people group or person at a certain time in history and culture in our world. And as we understand scripture, to understand it fully, you kind of have to have an understanding of that. You have to have an understanding of what was going on in that day and that age and who it was written to and why it was written there to help us understand scripture. Also, genre. The Bible contains a number of different genres. I mean, there's poetry, there's prose, there's letters. And you understand all those a little bit differently, right? And so as you read those, I mean, if I would tell you a poem, roses are red, violets are blue, sugar is sweet, and, well, thank you very much. Yeah, now, Now, is that true? Don't ask my wife. Is that true? Well, who knows? Are roses always red? No, violets? No. But is there truth in the poem? Well, yeah, there's truth in, you know what I'm saying? So when you interpret poetry, there's still truth there. I'm not saying it's not true, but you just interpret that a little differently than prose. I mean, that's just the way literature works. And the scripture has different kinds of literature in it. But here is where we hang our hat, that all scripture is God-breathed or inspired by God and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped in every good work so that we can know what God wants for us and how we can find life in him. When we say that scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit, you know, some people, what does that mean? Does that mean like the person that was writing, were they put in a trance and they didn't even know their hand was moving and God literally moved their hand? Well, I particularly don't believe that. Some people do, and that's fine. I really think that when it says a scripture has been inspired, is that God has blessed it, God ordained it, God spoke to the author, and they wrote it. But they wrote it in their language because, well, David was a shepherd. So when he wrote, you read a lot of David's Psalms, he uses a lot of metaphors about being a shepherd. I mean, that's just who he was. Luke was a physician, so he's very exacting in how he wrote, and that's just who he was. God uses us who we are, and he gives us the ability to write that. And then the question is then, can we really trust what was written? Well, I think we can because, for one, Scripture says so. And we'll talk about that in just a little bit, but about why we can really trust these books. But let me finish up real quick here. Why these 66 books? Theophilus said there are many accounts written about the life of Jesus. Just those four Gospels? Probably not. Probably there was a bunch of others. Why do we only have those four? Why do we only have these 66 documents in this book? That's a great question. So here's the answer. First, the authority of the books. The books that are in the scripture, so let me stop and go back. Okay, I can go back with my new clicker. This is pretty cool. Okay, I'll go back. So why do we have these 66 books? Well, first, the Old Testament is easy. The Old Testament is easy because the Old Testament is the book that Jesus used. I mean, you read the Gospels and you hear Jesus quoting Psalms, quoting Isaiah, talking about Genesis. I mean, and so the Old Testament is the book Jesus used. So we kind of got the Jesus stamp of approval on the Old Testament. Why the 27 books in the New Testament? Because those were written after Jesus was resurrected. Well, first off, there it is again, the authority of the books. In other words, the people who wrote those books, they either knew Jesus or knew somebody who walked with Jesus and got their information from them. I mean, they had an air of authority, apostolic authority, to write the books. Not only that, but the use of the books. For the first 3-4 centuries, these books were readily used in all worship services. All across the globe, people would use it. Pastors would teach from it. There was consensus theologically that these were Holy Scripture. And finally, the consensus of the church. The church came together in the 4th century with a couple councils, and they actually affirmed these books. They actually got together and said, yeah, this is it. These are the ones that we want to use. Now, can we trust it? Can we trust the Bible? And that's a tough question, because listen, if this is the Word of God for us, I mean, if it really is, that's given a lot of power to this book, isn't it? That's a lot of power that we're given this book. So the question is, can we trust it? Well, let me just give you some facts. First off, the Bible has been preserved remarkably well. What do I mean by that? There is no other ancient text that we have as many fragments or whole documents as we do the Bible. It just doesn't exist. It's in a category all on its own. And as they discover and uncover more ancient texts, you know what? They agree with what we've already found. So it's been preserved remarkably well. Not only that, the Bible is internally consistent. From Genesis to Revelation, you read it and the themes within that scripture is all consistent over the whole entire 66 documents. And that's amazing, considering it's written over a 1,600-year period of time. Finally, it's historically accurate. Again, and the more the archaeologists, are digging, and the more they're finding, the more truths they're finding about what's written in here is actually accurate. These cities, these places, these communities, these towns, these people actually existed. This is not a figment of somebody's imagination. Finally, the Bible has been verified by fulfilled prophecy. If you read the Old Testament and then you read the New Testament, especially about Jesus, you will find that every prophecy about Jesus came true in who that he was and who that he is. And finally, the Bible has led to changed lives. Now, let me be careful here. It is Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit that changes our lives, not this book. But this book tells us of the one who does come and change our lives and makes a difference. And all I can say to that is, that's true for me. And I bet if we'd raise our hands, that's true for a number of you here in this room today. Can we trust the scripture as it is written? Well, for me, I also think that this is God's holy word, and it's exactly the way he wants us to have it. If God didn't want something in this book, he could have easily lost it throughout time. I mean, just think of it. And this book was not mass-produced until 1445. You know what happened in 1445? A guy by the name of Gutenberg invented a printing press, and this was the first book printed on it. And so if God did not want something in this book to be in this book, I just think he's big enough to have lost it on purpose, right? But I think because God is who that he is and he's given us this book, that it is the truth for us to wrestle with and to know who that he is. And it is so powerful. That's why we encourage people to, when you study God's word, to do it in community, because it is complex and it does. People do disagree at times on it. And in that disagreement, in that wrestling is where we actually get drawn closer to God. And that's why we encourage people to be part of study groups, be part of a small group, be part of a group of people that opens God's word and says, what does this mean and how are you applying it in your life? And how does it make a difference for you? And so my final question today is just this simple one. We talked about it earlier. If not the Bible, then where do you get your understanding about God? Because if it's not the Bible, where is it? Because the danger is, here's the danger. The danger becomes when I say, well, I just don't believe that to be true. Well, okay, I get you, I feel you, I understand that. Why not? Well, I just don't feel it. Well, okay, but somebody across the aisle may feel it. Who's right and who's wrong? We have two gods? Because then we got somebody else on the other side that believes something. I mean, if we don't have a source, then where do we find our truth about God? And if that source is only internal, then you know what that makes you? That makes you God. And that makes every other person their own God. And that makes the world a very dangerous place, doesn't it? And so my challenge to you today is simply this. If not the Bible, where do you get your understanding about God? And maybe for some of you today, you're like, yeah, it's the Bible. And maybe you're sitting there and right now there's a passage that's coming across your mind and you're going, yeah, but I just really don't like that one. Well, you're not alone there either. There's a lot of things that are kind of hard to swallow sometimes. But I have found that as I apply them to my life just ultimately gets better. And here's the deal for us as a church. As a church, this is our source book. And we will always go back to this book to find the truth of who God is, who we are, and how we are to live according to his desire for us. That's what it means, that this is part of our core beliefs. This is God's word for us today, so that we may find life and find it in him more abundantly. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truths that are found in it. And we pray, God, that we can be found faithful to do our best to wrestle and to search the scriptures. God, we don't get it right a lot of times, God. But God, our heart is to follow you. So give us your wisdom, give us your guidance as we find our life and we find the truth about you through your word. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.